not claim to know a great deal about the lakes, but I wanted to hand out the map because several people that have either signed up as sponsors for the book project or said that they're interested also have no idea where the lakes are. So if you look at the side of the map that says 1880 down at the bottom, this is from the Oxford County Atlas of 1880, and if you look near the bottom in the center of the map, you'll see Bethel, Bethel and Uri and Riley. The Richardson Lakes, of course, are part of the Rangeley Lakes chain, and they're located due north of Bethel, up where that circle is. I know many of you are familiar, you know that the South Arm Road leads from Andover to the lakes. If you flip the map over, you'll see a blown-up version of the lakes. The slides that I'll be presenting tonight are in the order that Herb Sheriffs had them in for his chapters in the book, so they're not geographically arranged. And I'd just like to briefly go over some of the sites here on this map that we'll talk about. At the bottom of the map is the Andover Road or the South Arm Road that leads from the lower right up to South Arm, the south end of Lower Richardson Lake, or as it's called here, Weller Kennebecook. If you follow the lake up a bit, you'll notice on the left the dam lot, where Middle Dam is located. You'll also notice the road running from Angler's Retreat over to Sunday Cove. Of course, it was on that road that Louise Dickinson Rich lived when she wrote a good part of her book, We Took to the Woods. If you go back to the lake and then follow it up, you'll notice that at the time that this map was published, there was almost a third lake here between Upper and Lower Richardson. Herb Sheriffs talks about this in his book, but because the Middle Dam has been rebuilt, the lake level is now higher than what you see on this map, so that characteristic of a third lake has pretty much disappeared. Following up through, notice an Upper Richardson Lake where it says J.P. Whitney's Camp. This is very near Metallic Island, or Pine Island, where Metallic once resided. We'll be seeing photographs of the Whitney Camp shortly. Follow the lake, the east side of the lake up, and you'll see the other dam lot where Upper Dam is located. And we'll be seeing some interesting photographs of that. So as we go through the slides tonight, I hope any of you that have any comments or any corrections, I'm going by Herb's captions pretty much, will feel free to speak right up and correct me. We do have 138 slides, so I'm not going to spend much time on each one of them. I want to go over them rather rapidly. The other thing I want to mention is that if any of you are interested in having the book when it's published, and hopefully it'll be out in early spring of next year, and if you're not on the Society's mailing list, there's a sheet up front on the wooden table for you to put your name and your address on. We'll be sending out a special flyer with a discounted price for the Richardson Lakes book sometime shortly, probably within a couple of months. So if you're not on our mailing list, please put your name on that. This first photograph is significant in many ways because this,
come on down here.
Well, by the way, before I do this too, I'd like to also thank Alan Fraser. It was Alan who spent a great deal of time converting all of Herb's photographs into this slide program. And Alan's been very good to the Society in copying lots and lots of old photographs and also helping me identify many of these. This is Gammon's Sunset Camps at South Arm. And in 1967 and 68, Herb and Libby Sheriffs came to South Arm. They had gone to Weld originally, and Herb thought that Webb Lake and Weld was much too civilized. And they went out on a rainy day, and they ended up driving up the South Arm Road and came to Lower Richardson Lake, and they were really captivated by the lake and eventually spent a couple of summers there and eventually had their own cottage. As many of you know, they spent a good many years there. Herb went around talking to all sorts of people, gathering information into a manuscript that we're about to publish. Unfortunately, Herb died a short while ago, but his family has been very cooperative in helping us out. The cottage in the center, the one here on the right, the dark one, is where they stayed. In a chapter of the book, Herb talks about some of the early Indian occupants of the Richardson Lakes area. He focuses on Metallic, but he also talks about some of the other Indians that we know by name that supposedly either lived in the area or roamed through the area. He also gives a summary of some of the early artifacts that have been found in and around the Richardson Lakes. If any of you were here for Eric White's program several years ago, he told us a great deal about some of the things that he has discovered there. This gouge was found near Metallic Island in 1984. And since that time, of course, a number of other artifacts have been found in that vicinity. So the area is very interesting, very rich in artifacts. And there's still a lot more to be learned. Many people, of course, wonder how the Richardson Lakes got their names. Their name for George Frost Richardson, who was born in Lymington, Maine in the 1790s. In the 1830s, because he was a land speculator, he took advantage of very cheap land in the Richardson Lakes area. He bought over 24,000 acres of land in what is now Richardson Town Township, up around Upper Richardson, for 12 cents an acre. And he sold it within a year or two, I think for about 19 or 20 cents an acre, and made some money on that. He sold all of it except for 600 acres, and he built himself a farm near Metallic Brook on Upper Richardson Lake, and the X that you see in this photograph marks the spot where his farm stood, because the lake level has been raised. Today, you really don't see this much of the time, thanks to Doris Kennett, who's here tonight, former manager of the South Arm Campground. We have a wonderful air photo looking down on top of the remains of the Richardson Farm and the foundation work, so that will be included in the upcoming book. He lived in the area for several years. He advertised his farm as a help farm, and there were people that came into the area. He managed, with the help of four other men, to get a horse and a buggy up to the site, and then went in the Portland papers and advertised that you could reach this land near the Richardsons with a horse and wagon. And once people got up there, they realized that they had been taken, but by that time, he had made some money off them. Herb Sheriffs has a very interesting chapter on the history of Andover, especially the period in Andover's history of the 19th century when it was a major stopping place on the route to the Richardson Lakes. This is, of course, before railroads were built into the area. There were a number of major hotels, summer boarding places in Andover. This was the Andover House that stood right next to the common at the four-way intersection in the center of Andover Village. A wonderful early photograph. It's one of many stereo views that Herb Sheriffs copied for his collection. Here you see the Andover House on the left and the Androscoggin Lakes Transportation Company steamer at South Arm on the right, along with one of the wagons that could be hired to take you up the South Arm Road at one time to South Arm. This is the Milton House in Andover, again another place where summer tourists once came, spent a great deal of time. Many of them stayed in Andover or went north to the lakes. The homestead, this of course is still standing, and it's across from the cemetery as you go into Andover. It was begun in the 1790s by the Poor family, later expanded by the 1840s and 50s. They were taking summer boarders here, and a great number of rooms that produced for many, many years as a summer watering place. Some of you may remember this structure on Main Street. This was the Gregg House that burned a number of years ago. Again, another fairly early 19th century home in Andover that was later expanded and used as a summer boarding place. And this is French's Hotel. It also stood on Main Street in Andover. It was later known as the Twitchell when the Twitchell family of Bethel, a branch of the family, took it over. And then I think it was known as the Bluemont Inn, Alan?
Yeah.
Bluemont Inn, later burned, but it was a wonderful Victorian hotel. And you can see an excellent photograph of it here. Herb has a chapter devoted entirely to transportation in and around the Richardson Lakes, and he again has collected a number of very interesting photographs. When we first began looking at the manuscript, we realized if we just took the photographs and published those that it would be a very interesting project, but I'm up to 121 pages now of text, and when we add the 250 or 300 photographs, I think we'll have quite a quite a publication. This is the carriage wagon that was used at one time to carry guests to Middle Dam from Umbagog Lake. They would come by steamer from Upton, cross Umbagog, and then go across the carry road, which would take them to Lower Richardson Lake. The Angler's Retreat building is here on the left at Middle Dam. And notice out in the lake all the logs. Of course, at one time, booming logs and running logs down through Upper Dam, and then Middle Dam was a very active type of thing involving lots and lots of people. And Herb has a number of photographs of that. This is that south arm, another wagon full of guests. This is on the south arm road, from heading from Andover to the lakes. A very good photograph. Herb has all of these identified. In many cases, we know who the people are, and we know exactly where the location is. If it's a nice program, I haven't attempted to memorize that. If you want to know, you'll have to buy the book. This is another view of a wagon that carried guests from Umbagog Lake to the Angler's Retreat at Middle Dam. Herb goes into some detail about the coming of the railroad. By 1895, the Rumford Falls and Ranger Lakes Railroad had been built from Rumford up through to Bemis, at one time advertised as the only log railroad station in the world. This was on the eastern side of Moosic-Magundic Lake, and soon after this line was pushed through, eventually went to Quossick and further on, steamers began to run from near the railroad station across Moosic-Magundic and then over to Upper Dam, where people could easily get onto other steamers on Upper Richardson Lake. Of course, this is no longer standing today, and the rail line itself is long gone. A man by the name of Frederick Barker was very much involved in developing resorts and steamboating on the Moosic-Magundic as well as Upper Richardson Lake. This is his first steamer, the Aquasic. Ran mostly on Moosic-Magundic, but for a while it also ran on Upper Richardson. We have a wonderful collection of many of the steamers that ran on the lakes. This is part of the staff of the Upper Dam House. A photograph was taken near Upper Dam. One of the steamers and the top part of the steamer still exists at the Bellevue camps in that area. A part of that is still with us. This is on Upper Richardson, one of the steamers that was operated for a good many years by the Androscoggin Lakes Transportation Company. The first steamboat company was named the Richardson-Rangeley Lake Steamboat Company, started in the 1870s. Currently, it was taken over and expanded by this Androscoggin Lake Steamboat Company, and there probably were five or six of these large steamers running at any one time. This is the Captain Farrer. If any of you have studied the history of the Androscoggin Lakes, or as they're known today, the Rangeley Lakes, you may have heard of Captain Charles A.J. Farrer, who wrote a number of guidebooks. He was a great promoter of tourism, and he was also the president of this steamboat company. And the steamer that you see here, which was quite large for an inland lake, reminiscent of some of those that operated on Moosehead Lake, was called the Captain Farrer. You can see ALTC up on the front of the boat. Another view of it. This boat ended its days on Moosic-Magundic Lake. It was actually brought overland a short distance, think about a quarter of a mile between Upper Richardson and Moosic-Magundic Lake, and then it caught fire near an island near Upper Dam. But it served to carry tourists around the lakes for many, many years. Another steamer on Upper Richardson. You notice the log boom on the right. This is a very interesting view. This is Upper Dam on the left, the Upper Dam House, the hotel in the background, begun in 1853. We'll see some more photographs of that shortly, and then another steamer. Again, another steamer at Upper Dam. And again, these are on Moosic-Magundic Lake because the Upper Dam area, even though it's not on geographically on Upper Richardson, Herb has included a great deal about it because many people stayed there and then went just below into Upper Richardson Lake. This is the first South Arm House, or as it was once called, the Lakeview Cottage. It was built in 1882, later added to, and it was built by the Richardson Rangeley Lakes Transportation Company to house some of their guests. It stood for a number of years. Someone has said, or at least told Herb, that the top part of the building was later taken off and then moved up the lake, and part of it may still exist today. You can see the steamer here in the background. Rather interesting. A little bit of dry cotton behind the building. Herb was fascinated by all of this wood that had floated in, and he has a good many photographs of it. Rather interesting feature of the lake. Of course, the other interesting feature I find interesting anyway is that the lake level is constantly going up and down, so the shorelines here look unlike many of those in the area. Some of you may remember Mrs. Graves, who once ran the Sunset Dining Room and Cabins at South Arm. This is one of the ads that Herb has in the collection. We'll be adding a number of other things from the Society's collection, including some ads from the 1870s and 1880s, the stage lines and steamboat lines. A steamer and a buckboard at South Arm. And of course, many of these engravings and woodcuts are out of guidebooks. We have seen some of the original photographs, as a matter of fact, taken by Captain Farrar, and he later used these in the guidebooks. Joshua G. Rich, who once lived in Bethel, has been credited with founding what was later known as the Angler's Retreat. Herb also suggested that it may have been another man by the name of Rich that ran the place. We know now, since his death, after going through some of the old Bethel couriers upstairs, that his brother helped him a great deal, and because J.G. Rich, this man, lived in Upton during the early years of the Angler Retreat's existence, we know now that it was his brother that probably was running it for most of the time. Beginning around 1860 or 1861, Mr. Rich began the construction of this. There's two cabins attached here. This is from a stereo view that belongs to the Maine Historic Preservation Commission. And for many, many years, this was all that was available to sportsmen. They would come up to South Arm on a very primitive road, or come across the Carry Road from Onbegog Lake, and they would stay here under very primitive conditions. We have several published accounts of how terrible things were here. One man complained because he said the cow was allowed to wander in the front yard, and to get from the lake to the cabin, you had to sort of straddle and go around and up in the course of cow droppings. He said the food was very bad and the health was not very good, but the fishing was excellent, and that was worth putting up with all of the disadvantages. So this place stood fairly close to the site of Middle Dam for a good many years until it was later replaced by this building. In 1877, Aldana Brooks and Mr. Godwin from Upton purchased what was left of the barns at the Richardson farm on Upper Richardson Lake. They took them apart, probably during the wintertime, I'm not sure. But anyway, they moved the material down to near Middle Dam, and they replaced Mr. Rich's early Angler's Retreat with this structure, a 2.5-story building that became the new Angler's Retreat. And the rooms, though they were very sparsely furnished and very plain, were a big improvement over that early log building that we saw before. Herb has a large number of photographs of this place, and I'm sure there are many of you here tonight that can remember it. It didn't burn until the 1950s. Really quite a substantial building. Here we see it with the sign up on the roof and some of the people, some of the staff that work there. Ed Coburn, who was from Bethel originally in the 1890s, took over the management and possibly the ownership of the Angler's Retreat, and he ran the place very successfully for a number of years. He had his own steamers that ran from South Arm up to Middle Dam. This is a photograph of Captain Coburn, as he was later called, his dog in later years. He ran the place for many, many years. It was Captain Coburn that did a great deal of publicity in the early part of this century, including producing this booklet, which was copied for us by Alan Fraser. Matter of fact, I think it's Alan Fraser's booklet. Shows a wonderful view of the angler's retreat from the end of the wharf. Cabins on the left, some of which still stand. In the booklet, which was similar to other little publicity brochures and what have you handed out by sporting camps in the area, we have a list of some of the places that people could visit. You notice they give Rapid River as a half a mile away, Pond in the River, half a mile, Metallic Brook, 4 miles on Upper Richardson Lake. The interesting thing, I think, about all of this material is that very little has been published on sporting camps and on the history of the Rangeley Lakes, and in many ways, the Richardson's very typical of what was going on throughout the entire state, so I think another reason that this will have wide interest when the material is published. This is part of the menu from the Angler's Retreat. I found it interesting. They leave some places open, of course, to write in, and here we have, under fish, we have trout from the Big Woods, and I don't know what the rest of it is, but obviously fish was something that they had in plentiful supply and one of the things that they were known for later on. A little bit of everything, including honeycomb trout under meat. Here we have a good photograph of the cabins at Lakewood Camps. Many of these were spared when much of the place burned in the 1950s. There was also another fire in 1967. And lots of photographs of hunting scenes and fishing scenes. These are the cabins north of the Angler's Retreat building, north of the main building. Many of these were given names from famous guests that came back year after year. And of course, many of the guests that came here were quite well-to-do. Herb tells us that, I think, in 1957, I'm not sure when the place burned, when the main building burned, someone apparently got more insurance coverage for their collection of bamboo rods that were stored in the building than the building itself. So there were a very large number of well-to-do guests that were coming up and spending time here. Another view of some of the cabins. There's a good collection of views of the wharf, which still exists in front of the Angler's Retreat, or as it's now known as the Lakewood Camps. You can see here one of the steamers out in the lake with the narrows up on the left-hand side of the photograph. Over the year, the wharf was expanded. Eventually, there was this large sort of pavilion down at the end of it. Another very good view here, showing some boats, buildings in the background. You notice a little railway on the wharf itself. Right here, you can see that. And I haven't learned much about that. I assume that was the baggage. Does anyone? It
came from the woodshed for the all wood to the steamers.
All wood, okay, great. We have a very good large blow up of this photograph that's been loaned to us by Doris Kennett, and we're thinking very strongly of using this on the cover of the book. The Lakewood Camps has been a real good supporter of the project so far, and I think this really says a lot about some of the things that were going on the Richardsons, and I think it's a very appealing photograph, so it's one that we have under consideration. Again, out at the end of the wharf, a view from the roof of this pavilion, looking back towards South Arm. This is a great photograph, cutting ice in front of the Angler's Retreat in the wintertime. And I've told this story to a few people. Reading through Herb's manuscript, I was sort of shocked to hear what Ed Coburn often did involving cutting ice on the lake. He would rent horses, or borrow horses, and quite often they would fall through the ice and would drown. And he would get in touch with the people and then somehow tell them that he had to have these horses because they were the best horses he'd ever had. And the people would say, all right, you can sell them. You never tell them that the horses can die. You always tell them that they charge more if the horses can die. On occasion, they could save the horses, and Captain Colburn's method was to place a rope around the horse's neck until the horse choked and then managed to swell up with air a little bit so it would float. And then they would haul the horses out of the hole and quite often save them that way. We do have a record of quite a few of them, unfortunately, drowning in the lake. And of course, they had to cut this ice for use in the summertime and use that for many, many years. Here's a more recent view of the place, again, just before the fire. Alice and Larry Parsons took over the Anglers Retreat, the Lakewood Camps, after Captain Colburn, and they ran it for many, many years. Larry has since died, but Alice on the left, and shown here on the right in a more recent photograph, is a sponsor of the Richardson Lakes Book Project. And again, if any of you are interested in becoming sponsors, for $100 or more, you get a complimentary copy of the book, and you get your name listed inside the book. So if some of you would like to do that, we're glad to talk to you afterwards. Here we have the, it was called the Alar, which was their boat from Angler's Retreat. Here it is down at South Arm. It would bring guests up to Middle Dam. This photograph is labeled Hen Hutchins, who supposedly could cut ice in any shape or form. He was one of the employees at the Angler's Retreat Lakewood Camps for a while. This is the only photograph that we have in the collection, in Herb's collection so far, showing the fire destroying the Angler's Retreat in the 1950s. And if anyone else knows of a better photograph or has it, we'd love to love to see it. This is taken from the Putnam Lad Cottage on Horsebead Point, which is up in the beginning of the Narrows, I guess. And, tremendous fire, and unfortunately destroyed much of the property. Here we have Sue and Stan Milton, who are the current owners of the Lakewood Camps. And the building in the background is the building that has replaced that large 2.5-story structure that we've seen so many times. We know from newspaper accounts and from diaries, what have you, that there were loggers that were stationed at Upper Dam by the 1850s. And we know that these two buildings, which were located where the Upper Dam House Hotel stood, went back to at least 1856. One was used as a dining hall, one was used as a dormitory. This photograph, again, is another stereo view from the Maine Historic Preservation Commission in Augusta. We also know that the dams, Middle Dam, Upper Dam, what was once called Lower Dam, or Pond and the River Dam, go back to the 1850s. The first dams built there were constructed in 1853, and of course since that time have been rebuilt several times. You saw dry kai in the foreground. In the other photograph here, we see logs. You can see how close to the water these are located. These were located just below the dam. Eventually, the one here on the left was incorporated into the later Upper Dam House. This is the building that took their place and stood until 1958, when it was torn down. A very large building, had a large dining hall, had lots of dormitory rooms. A good number of guests, of course, would come here and either stay in the hotel or stay in the small cabins on the left and would come back year after year. A little closer view of the building, sort of a very plain Victorian building, had this little cupola up on the roof. Later on, raised the roof and made a full second story in it. Another view. You can see how far back that L on the side went. It was really quite a large building. This is the inside of the lobby in the hotel. And you can see that even though it was in a fairly isolated location, they had a number of things here to amuse guests. There's a square piano on the right. A very large fireplace in the background. At one time, there was a contest that went on to see which sporting camp in Maine had the largest fireplace. And supposedly one on Kennebago had a fireplace. fireplace larger than this, they went up and measured it and discovered that this one was 9 inches wider. So it was really quite a large granite fireplace, very attractive. We have this postcard view from the Society's collection, again showing Moose of Burgundic on the right, the Upper Dam House here on the left. This is a little blurry, but it's interesting because it shows the fishermen in the stream just below the pool, just below Upper Dam, of course, very famous for trout and salmon. Hotel in the background. This is the way the building looked in the 1950s. It was operated by a man by the name of Malcolm Grant up until 1952, and then it was closed, and in 1958 the building was torn down. This is the dance hall. They really had a small community there that functioned in the summer season. The dance hall was on the south side of Upper Dam, and it too was taken down in the 1950s. The flooring was transferred down to the Angler's Retreat, was used in the dining room of the hotel there. This was taken right after the 1938 hurricane, and if you look on the right, you can see some of the damage that took place to the trees around this dance hall. This is the view of Moose Lake McGuntick from the Upper Dam House area. And maybe Eric can help me with this one. I think we're on Upper Richardson looking towards the Ziskars?
Yeah, it's Observatory Mountain.
Observatory.
Route 16 runs just this side of it. Mm-hmm.
Now, is this low water?
Low water, very low.
Yeah. In the history that Herb assembled, there's a great deal of information about the Pingree connection with the land ownership in and around the Richardson Lakes. Many of you today, of course, have heard of the Seven Islands Land Company. The Pingree heirs, of course, formed that a number of years ago. Cohen Pingree is also another name you may have heard over the years. David Pingree was much like George Frost Richardson in that he purchased a great deal of land around the lakes at one time, and for that reason, much of the shoreline today around the lakes is undeveloped. And we got a letter from a man in Andover, and he said, well, he was glad to become a sponsor of the project and was interested in it. And he said, if nothing else, Herb's book will help preserve the way the Richardson Lakes area once looked, because there's beginning to be a great deal of talk about expanding the roads and building more cottages and what have you. And I think one of the unique things about the Richardsons is that they really aren't as developed as some of the other lakes in this vicinity. And so hopefully that won't change a great deal. But the Seven Islands Land Company have become sponsors of the project. And again, there's a great deal in the book about the Pingree connection. I think many of you will find it interesting. This is Mr. J. Parker Whitney, and he again was a well-to-do summer resident. He built his own cottage on the east side of Upper Richardson Lake near Mosquito Brook. Quite a few years ago, we were given a large collection of photographs of the Richardson Lakes area. Becky Kendall has since given us another collection, and we're finally able to identify many of these photographs thanks to the ones that Herb provided. This is Mr. Whitney's camp as it looked originally. Here's an actual photograph of it, and Herb has an entire chapter devoted to the old camps on the Richardsons with a number of photographs of many of the older ones. This was expanded over the years. You can see here great additions on the left. Many of these places, of course, had their own marine railways from boathouses and storage buildings down into the lake, and many had their own small steamers, and they pull them out in the late fall. And some of these still exist today. The remnants are still there in some cases, and that's another interesting feature that we don't see on many of the other lakes in this region. Well, along with writing guidebooks and being the president of the Androscoggin Lakes Transportation Company, Captain A.J. Farah was also the publisher of Stereo Views in and around the Richardson and Rangeley Lakes. And this is one of the stereo views that he produced of the Bellevue camps, a very early view. This is, according to her, this is the oldest set of camps that still exist on the Richardsons. And I don't know for sure if that's true. They go back at least to 1864. We do have a number of good photographs of these in the collection. Here again, a low lake level. This view is one that I've seen published in a number of books on New England history, a very famous view of a sporting camp. In this photograph, fairly recent photograph, we have Libby Sheriffs on the left. This is Herb's wife. We have Archer Poor in the center, who for many years was the caretaker here at the property, and Mrs. Roland Evans on the right, the owner of the property. We've recently copied some photographs owned by Don Brooks and his wife of Vivevale Camp, and according to the information that we've been able to dig up, this it still exists in a remodeled state on the Richardson Lakes. Really wonderful 19th century photographs of these sports, relaxing after a long day of fishing. Here we have the same camp with a steamer out front. And according to Herb's labeling, this is the same location today. And I don't really know. Is anyone familiar with that location?
I would think Beaver Man is there. That's an old Stevens camp right there.
Okay, we'll have to do some checking. Herb has it penciled on, and supposedly that was the location. I'm not really sure. Does it still exist, Herb?
Not by that name.
No.
If June was here, he could tell you about the pools.
Deer Park Lodge is another one that supposedly still exists today. Ann Pearson, supposedly the owner of this. Have a number of good photographs. You notice, even though many of these cottages are in a fairly remote location, that people have managed to build fairly substantial buildings here, and they brought very comfortable furniture with them. Photographs of the same location. Many of them, of course, had their own sets of outbuildings. They had ice houses and woodsheds and what have you. Photograph from the lake looking up at the camp. This is the Putnam Ladd cottage on Horse Beach Point. It was begun in 1908. It has supposedly has eight fireplaces inside. I've never been to this location, so I don't know. I've been by it in a boat. It's a fairly large cottage, as you can see. This is the estate, the buildings on Beaver Island. This is at the north end of Upper Richardson. And someone has also told me that there's a good deal of this that's been torn down. Is that true?
No.
It's all still there?
Tall building, by the way, was a squash court. The window's way up high.
What's the family that owns this?
Briggs, what's our friend's name?
Kendall.
Several people should recognize this. This is the Thurston camp. According to Herb's notes, Paul Thurston took over ownership of this in 1925. I don't know whether that's true or not. It's a wonderful photograph. This again is another cottage that supposedly still exists at the north end of Upper Richardson Lake. sure the owners, but again, it's typical of the buildings around the lake. There are a number of photographs. This one, unfortunately, is a little blurry, of cottages along Rapid River between Middleman and Pond and the River, and this is one of those. Well, there are a good number of photographs in the collection of the dams, Middle Dam, Pond and the River, and Upper Dam, and taken throughout their history. This is an interesting aerial view of Middle Dam. I'm sure many of you have been to this location with Rapid River running below it. Well, we have some fairly early photographs. We know, again, it was begun in 1853. We know it was rebuilt in the 1870s and rebuilt again in the 1880s. The dams supposedly were built originally to, of course, to hold back the water and involving log drives, but eventually they became very important for controlling the flow of water to downriver mills. And of course, today they're owned and operated by the Union Water Power Company in Lewiston. There are many, many tourist guidebooks and little souvenir brochures that have been produced over the years. This is one of those. It shows the famous trout pool below Middle Dam. And the lower side of Middle Dam. Fairly large structures, of course. Substantial to withstand the elements. Again, the pool below Middle Dam. Pond in the river, of course, down below. Pond in the River Dam, in some old sources, is called Lower Dam. Here we see a photograph of that structure, which I'm told no longer stands.
Yeah,
is it still there?
A portion of it is there.
A portion of it? I'll be calling several of you before this book comes out. I wondered what the walkway was up on the roof, and digging around in Herb's notes, I discovered that on this dam, as well as on some of the others, they had large barrels full of water for fire protection, and these were kept on top of the dams in case the roof caught fire. Another view of the dam. We have this early view of Upper Dam during the 1870s. You can see most of it, of course, is made out of wood. We have some pretty good descriptions of visitors, thanks to visitors coming here in the 1870s and 1880s, of what this dam looked like. Parts of it went out in floods and then had to be rebuilt. This is one of the construction photographs that we have in the collection showing the actual construction of Upper Dam, or the rebuilding of Upper Dam. A later photograph, at one time there was a sawmill here on the left, as well as a number of other buildings that are no longer standing. You notice here the roof is clear, but in this photograph we have that walkway with the barrels up on top of the building. Again, the mill on the left. During the Second World War, there were gates and fences around the dam to help protect it from sabotage. And there were guards stationed up at Upper Dam as well as at Middle Dam. This is a view looking down at the dam. The little building here in the foreground was used as a guardhouse during World War II. This is a view taken from the opposite end. The dance hall that we saw before is here on the left, and you can see the gate. Closed at the time this photograph was taken. Nice aerial view of Upper Dam. Gives you a good idea of where things were located. You can see the dance hall on the right, the dam in the center, the mill just to the left of it, and then the cabins and the Upper Dam house on the left. And another view just below Upper Dam, the logs that have floated in. Cabins in the background. Notice the boats have been pulled out while they were driving logs. People had to get their boats out of this waterway. Booming logs up above Upper Dam. Good view of the Upper Dam house in the background. Another log boom just above Upper Dam. and a few logs waiting to be sluiced through Upper Dam. This was labeled as Arnie and Barbara Mayberry, just above Upper Dam. This is the capstan that was used to pull in log booms above the dam at one time. Herb has a couple of chapters devoted to logging, lumbering, fishing, and hunting. It has wonderful views of logging camps in and around the Richardson Lakes area, as well as logging going on right on the lakes themselves. Here you can see a huge collection of logs out in the lake itself, and of course these were being boomed and then hauled down to the various sluice gates at Middle Dam, and then sluiced down the Rapid River, down to the Androscoggin, and the paper mills. Here we have a winter scene that was labeled near Metallic Brook on Upper Richardson Lake. Of course, this went on throughout the winter, and then would stay in camps near the shoreline. This is supposedly a view of the logs being hauled between Rapid River and B Pond, I believe. I'm not sure exactly when, but it's one of the 20th century photographs that we have.
Should be able to identify it by
the
camera.
It's another scene here, supposedly in around the Rapid River area. Men are working. Here is how they piled the wood on the shore of the Rapid River. It really amazes me. Of course, they did all this by hand. At one time, logs were actually pulled from Upper Richardson Lake back upriver into Moosilik-Magundik. There was a mill on the east shore of Moosilik-Magundik run by Mr. Cummings, a birch mill, and birch was cut on the Richardson Lakes and then pulled up to near the Upper Dam area and then hauled on a continuous chain across into Moosilik-Magundik Lake. This is the way. This is the end of that sluice or chain area in Moosilik-Magundik Lake as it looked a good number of years ago. And this is the way the end of it looked, or looks today, on the Upper Richardson Lakes area. There's a large pulley, very large pulley out right near the water. This is about all that remains here. And this ran for a number of years up until the mill supposedly burned and then it was discontinued. We see a dynamiting of a jam just below Middle Dam. It's very dangerous work. We know from newspaper accounts of some of the things that Herb has in his manuscript that a number of men injured or killed in many of these log drives on the Rapid River and around the lakes. Most of, if not all, of the Ranger Lakes, of course, had these scows or tugs, towboats that pull log booms around the lakes, and for the most part these are gone. This was the roll or the rowel that was used on the Richardson Lakes. It had paddle wheels, of course, that you can see here boxed in at the end. This was cut up sometime after 1971. I'm not sure exactly. We have some photographs of it in the 1960s up on the edge of the lake. See, it was quite a substantial boat. We do have a film of this boat being used on Upper Richardson that we use for the White Mountain Elder Hospital program, and it's a film that we have upstairs if any of you are interested in seeing it. It was produced by the Brown Company years ago. Some people here tonight should recognize this. This was the Thurston Black Cat Mill that stood on the west shore of Lower Richardson Lakes up in Lake until 1933, I believe, when it burned. This was used by the Thurston family to cut birch squares, and the wood here, of course, eventually was taken down to South Arm and then down through Roxbury Notch down to Hale, where it went to the mill there. Jane and Dick Hosterman took me to this site on the trip we took on the Richardsons, and we caught around in the bushes and the trees, and we found what was left of this boiler. Very interesting thing that still stands there in the woods. Herb has a wonderful collection of fishing scenes in and around the lake. This is just one of them. This is down near South Arm. People, look at the size of the fish. People are always very proud of the fish that they caught here at the Richardson's, always trying to outdo each other on the length and the weight. Back before restrictions, I think, on fish. That one and this one. This was a publicity photograph that was taken at Upper Dam. The man in the foreground, I forget his name, but he was one of the guides that was available for hire at the Upper Dam House. A wonderful photograph. One of the hunting camps. And our final photograph, again, is the pool just below Upper Dam, and I think in many ways really summarizes why people have been fascinated for many, many years with the Richardson Lakes, why Herb was so interested in collecting information about the lakes, and again, another reason why we're very anxious to publish the book. So again, I remind you, if you have an interest and you're not on our mailing list, you want to know more about the book, please sign the sheet down at the front of the room. I'll be happy to answer some questions, but I think the Thurston family could do a much better job of it. So thank you very much.